Panoramiek, een overzicht van recente ontwikkelingen in Midden-Amerika, de voortduring van de strijd in El Salvador en de voorzichtige toenadering tussen Nicaragua en Washington. Midden-Amerika in een stroomversnelling, vanavond om 8:10 op deze zender.
En dan nu eerst de Amerikaanse Droom, een film van Nico Krama, D.B. Jones en George Sluiser, ter gelegenheid van de 200-jarige handelsrelaties tussen Nederland en de Verenigde Staten. Deze documentaire bevat 5 portretten van Amerikanen die op een bijzondere manier met Nederland verbonden zijn. De film is een co-productie van de NOS en de WNET 13 New York en zal deze maand in heel Amerika worden uitgezonden onder de titel The Dutch Connection.
...19 april 1782. John Adams kan dik tevreden achteroverleunen. De Verenigde Staten hadden hem naar Den Haag gestuurd om daar én diplomatieke erkenning en een stevige staatslening los te peuteren. Het lukt hem allebei. Aan zijn vrouw Abigail schrijft Adams: dit is nou zo'n volk dat degelijk, spaarzaam, zedelijk hoogstaand en vooral geletterd is. Een paar maanden later bericht hij aan thuis: dit land is er diep treurig aan toe, want het is enkel en alleen gespitst op winstbejag. De betrekkingen tussen beide landen zijn het innigst aan het einde van de Tweede Wereldoorlog. De beroemde televisiepresentator Walter Cronkite weet het nog goed.
I stepped foot on Dutch soil very unsteadily out of a crash glider. And it was a rather unusual way, I think, to arrive in a country for the first time. The people were individually were absolutely marvelous. Every American who came in, whether he had Dutch ancestry or not, was impressed with the courage of the Dutch people, of the friendliness of the Dutch people. I felt very definitely that I'd sort of come home. After 300 years, I'd come home.
Maar liefde slijt als het te veel van één kant komt.
Het ogenblik zendt uit de televisie. Dat betekent, de regering kijkt mee, Amerikanen kijken misschien vanavond mee. Zwaai even naar ze.
Thanks to improved communications, we know each other better. And when we know each other too well, we take each other for granted. I think that sometimes separation is a stronger bind for friendship than closeness is.
Nieuws bereikte ons in de 17e eeuw veel trager, maar toch nog snel genoeg om Amsterdamse kooplui ertoe te bewegen hun schepen te sturen naar Amerika om winst te halen.
I think that the Dutch coming from the flat lands of the Netherlands must have absolutely been bug-eyed when they sailed into what has become New York Harbor, into this beautiful estuary with Governor's Island back there and Manhattan Island, all of it then hilly, filled with trees. Must have been an absolutely gorgeous sight. I know one thing, we never should let the English have it.
Walter Cronkite's jacht heet Wijntje, een vrouwennaam.
The boat is named in honor of all those women who have made Cronkite men happy in the New World, named after the first woman who married a Cronkite in the New Amsterdam colony at the old Dutch Reformed Church, November 16, 1642, which was clearly within the first quarter of a century, barely 23 years after the colony was founded. And it was one of the early marriages, as a matter of fact, in the colony at all. Scholars tell me that Cronkite might have meant a pointed hat or pointed head. And I don't know if old Dutch to know whether that might be so or not. I have a great affinity for the Dutch people, which I suppose stems to a certain extent out of this heritage, although obviously it goes back a very long time. I think that's something which probably comes from desire to identify with a past and a history. Well, it'll be nice to contemplate sailing off to Rotterdam this afternoon. It's a beautiful day in Martha's Vineyard. I don't know how it is in Rotterdam today, but by the time we got there, it'd be a little different anyway, I suppose.
Ver voor Walter Cronkite schrijft een bezoeker uit de 17e eeuw: de Hollanders hebben meer gezond verstand dan verbeeldingskracht. Ze zijn eerder koppig dan bevlogen. Waar of niet, onze voorouders bouwen een vloot die de wereldzeeën beheerst. Tsaar Peter de Grote, vastbesloten om van zijn Rusland ook een grote zeemogendheid te maken, kwam hier om de Hollanders hun scheepsbouwkunst af te kijken. De bewondering van Tsaar Peter is overgegaan in de droom van een andere vreemdeling. Zomaar een vliegenier uit Chicago. Al heeft Bill Dutter nog nooit één stap op Hollandse bodem gezet.
Oké, we're all set. Hurricane brake?
Set.
Alternate and auxiliary hydraulic pumps are off. Oké. Okay. And radio altimeter circuit breakers, we'll pull those.
In December of 1969, a couple weeks before Christmas, I went to a model shop not too far from here.
Go ahead with the door, ladies.
And as I walked in the shop, they had approximately 25 or 30 model ships in kits on a wall. And I felt something kind of pulling. It's hard to believe this, but I looked at the kit of the Red Lion, even though there was many other ships. But I saw this little ship, a Dutch sailing ship, and I just had to buy it and start work on it. There was just something there that kind of pulled at my heartstrings. I'll be there in just a minute.
I can just remember coming home from work one day, and here he had the kitchen just totally set up for building this little model. The kitchen table had the wooden strips on it, the oven and the range had the wood being boiled in the water for the wood so it could be easily bent. And I'm like, oh my gosh, this is taking over my whole life. What's happening here?
And meanwhile, I go to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, on one of my trips, and I go to the library, and in this library I find a book that contains the history of the Red Lion, even though it's just a paragraph or two, and also the plans. I just became intrigued with what it would be like to sail a ship like the Red Lion back to the Netherlands, and it kind of planted the seed for this idea of building a replica. And it's progressed now through many years of hard work, a lot of sacrifices. Your budget is stretched to the maximum. Thank God I have a good wife that is understanding.
Bill's always made sure that he's had time to spend with me, and I don't feel in that respect that he's ever cheated me on any time. His utmost concern has been both us, our relationship, and his other love, his ship.
Many a night over the last 12 years, I find myself dreaming. I sometimes kid people and say this ship is like a Cleopatra, whereby her bow is very full and firm, her waist is tapered, and her transom is like the buttocks of a young lady. And I think that probably describes her best. But from a technical standpoint, the Dutch built these ships with a very full bow, and there was a purpose for it because they could carry more weight, and they were called apple-bowed or bluff-bowed.
Ieder weekend rijdt Bill Dotter in 5 uur naar het werfje waar zijn droom werkelijkheid wordt. Op honderden kilometers van het dichtstbijzijnde ruime sop, pal op het platteland van Wisconsin. Een gekke plek. Een beetje gekke man. Voor het nymfjes leest Homerus in het Grieks en Virgilius in het Latijns. Als op- en top vakman bouwt hij al 50 jaar lang schepen. Maar eentje als dat van Dotter? Nee.
I thought he was kidding at first, but when he came back, I'd say over a period of 3 years. First he came 1 year, he showed me the plans. And I thought, Second year he came back again. I showed my plans again. But the third year, he said, "Here's $3,000. I'm serious. I don't want you to get any other boats ahead of me now." So he gave me the money. That's how it started. And I was interested in building it because it was something different. And it would test your ingenuity. You get anything that's a little bit out of the ordinary, I like to do.
We started looking for the wood. We went out. Fur didn't go with me, but I went out to the woods with a farmer that's been cutting wood for the last 20 years for Ferd. And I was there and got pictures as the tree was felled for the keel. I became obsessed with learning more about shipbuilding and something of the Netherlands. And therefore I became involved through reading in metallurgy, shipbuilding, forestry, some of the history of the Netherlands, political science and geography. My interest in my early 20s, sports car, Jaguars, playing a lot of golf, and just kind of relaxing. I wasn't really interested in something of this magnitude.
Na 26.000 manuren precisiewerk en zowat 10 jaar salarissen van Dotter wordt de Rode Leeuw dan eindelijk onthuld. Alhoewel nog lang niet afgebouwd, betekent het vastnagelen van de laatste huidplank toch dat het schip zeewaardig is, dat het ooit onder zeil kan gaan. Toen trotseerde zij kolkende zeeën, bliksems en poolkou. Dat is toch voor herhaling vatbaar met stuurman Dotter aan de kolderstok.
And I said, "Would you mind building this old Dutch sailing ship?" And he took these plans and held them up. And he looked at them for about 2 minutes and decided, "I would love to build that ship." Now, many of you today probably feel that you're going to do a lot of celebrating. But actually, you're just here to help finish the ship. So,
we're putting you to work.
So we've got about a month's worth of work, and I don't know if we're going to run out of food or not, but Bird figures that with about 150 people, we should be able to get this thing all done. I feel that this ship should be sailed back to the Netherlands and at some time put in a museum in Amsterdam or Rotterdam for the people of the Netherlands to enjoy it. So much time with this ship, blood, sweat, and tears that I feel that I'm part Dutch now. This city is one of the most exciting places in the world. I haven't been around all that much, but I've spoken to a lot of people about that.
More exciting than The Hague?
Well, hell yes. You don't want to get that in. Yes, for sure.
Koos van den Akker, Hollander, tegen Heug en Meug. New York.
I tell you something which is so direct. The only times when I had nightmares when I first came here was when I dreamed that I was back in Holland. And I just, every time when I woke up and I found out I was still here, I was so pleased. Yeah, the head is good. There's so many details that are just so pretty you can work with. For a lot of people, this is just a lot of junk, but yeah, it's beautiful. It's just has color to me. It's all lines, it's all shadows, it's all very subtle colors. It's beautiful. It's like stitches. You can see it back in my work almost. Most designers work with a sketch first. It would make things very easy. I can't work like that. So. Things happen, you see. You invent things. It's like a painter. While you paint, you want more shadow, you want more light. With this is not finished, this is a start. And then you go over it and you work over it and you work in it and it becomes something. I need the freedom to do whatever I want to do on fabrics before I draw it down. Once it is drawn down, that's it. Then there is no changing. All the fabric for the collages in
we
the
got
house.
Everything for the collages.
Everything, no gonna, substitutes, no nothing, no
we will send everything exactly as it is. The car is going to be made 4 inches longer.
Yeah. And what are you going to do with the collages? Are they going to be the same or are you going to move them down?
No, we're going to move them down. We're going to move the collages down.
When we moved in here, we had four girls. We had this whole space and four girls sitting. And in a question of a month or two or three, what was it? It was filled up.
We've got to fill it up.
The women that come from the countries like Cuba and Argentina and Dominican Republic, they're born with a needle in their hands. They're little girls when they start sewing. They are the real experts. I couldn't work with American girls. They don't know nothing, really. And it's really those kind of, they're proud of the work. They do very secure work. This is very difficult, what we do. Sometimes it would be nice if I paid some compliments and all that, but I'm not too good in that.
Yeah, Gary, it's Barbara at Koos van den Akker. I would like some girls for tomorrow afternoon.
How it's elastic waistline.
Here.
Okay, fine, yes.
And then I think that's
yes,
enough.
It's pretty, very pretty. It makes all the difference at court.
And then we're going to use this as a line.
Yes, so and then there's going to be a tape around it, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Very good. Nice. Nice piece. Yep.
This is
all right.
Additional strapping.
Yes.
Toen Koos een rechterhand en een model nodig had, viel zijn oog op een Hollandse.
If anything else, she is lovely and very representable for my clothes.
And it is a wonderful advertisement for
Why
me.
Why Dutch?
Why Dutch? Pure accident. Please, pure accident. Nothing to do with anything. And we right away made the agreement that if she would work for me, we would not speak Dutch.
How did that happen, the leaving from Holland?
Well, it wasn't a make for a long time. I think the best inspiration for that was the movie Breakfast at Tiffany's. I saw that in London for the first time, and I fell madly in love with New York. I thought it was romantic, it was glamorous, it had everything that I wanted. And I started planning heavily about it. I paid my bills, most of my bills. I took $168 and a portable sewing machine, and I left, and I had big dreams, and they were never, ever disappointed. I arrived on a Saturday morning, just yesterday, 13 years ago, and I walked to the Empire State Building. I knew about that, and I climbed on top, and I looked around, and I couldn't believe it, and I loved it all. And I made clothes for people in the street, $20 dresses, $30 dresses, anything they wanted. I had a rough time, money-wise, of course. I know every bank in New York City. I know what it is to get a $3,000 loan. Ain't easy.
I have loved you for a long time.
My clothes.
Yeah. Well, now I've met you.
You never know. Pretty, pretty.
Thank
Look
you.
Around.
Thank you. I
love all those junks.
Nice. Yeah, I love junks.
Nice. Rattle, rattle, rattle. You know
you
it's Josephine.
You always know when I'm around.
Right.
Isn't this great?
Pretty. Wear blues.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You can handle that one, can you?
I can handle anything that's cloudy.
Can you use this on stage?
Sure, why not?
Pretty.
You can even cut the slit up a little higher.
Pretty.
When you do your, you know, your sort of wild number. It needs to be taken
she needs
in.
Some for her.
You need some kick up here.
What?
You need a jacket.
Yeah,
that's
exactly
like that. Oh, going. All right. My first dress that I made out of a laken with pearls sewn on it. I think I was 11 years old. And this was the very first expression of what I wanted to do. The first dress worn out meaning worn in the street. We went to Die Lustige Witwe in it. Unbelievable, made from the curtains from his zolderkamer. Yeah, and the girl, Poppy, who was my girlfriend, I guess. We were the same age. We used to go to church together. And she would wear creations. We would sit in the front rows and have everybody stare at us. That was the most fun of the whole bloody church. The army, me and my sewing machine. I had it good in the army. And in Holland, of course, there was nothing. It was children's stuff. The funny thing is, though, even being in this country, my designing is very Dutch. I have no explanation for that. I got a book from friends of mine a couple of years ago, and when I look through it, everything that's in the book is what I do, although I've never seen the costumes, and it is fascinating. The combinations of fabrics, the plaids with the prints, the woolens, the tweeds combined with the cottons, the little ribbons, it is absolutely amazing. I never saw it before until I got this book. The brocadeness, the big embroideries. I mean, I've never seen a woman walking around in Holland with shoulders all the way up in the air. I mean, it's wonderful. If you see something like this, for instance, this is my fashions. Where it comes from, God knows, but it's heritage, I guess.
Maar in het Holland van Koos' knapenjaren was zijn haute couture te gedurfd, te blitz. Misschien wel te origineel.
I think the Fatherland wrote, Koos van den Akker, so what? It was so negative, in a few words, like, big deal.
Big deal. Coach van den Akker, America. Big deal. I mean, it is always that. It is always that negative feeling. When my mother came for the first time in this city, she had seen it all on TV. Oh, yeah, look, mother, this. Oh, yeah, sure, yeah, I've seen it. Oh, we have big buildings, too, in Holland, you know.
Vaak kleren van Koos?
Ja, jawel. Ja. Maar ja, op dat wat nou zo werkelijk zo mooi is, dat spaar ik een beetje hoor. Nou, niet zo om dat zomaar aan te doen, nee. Want als er dan eens iets is, nou dan ben je netjes zoals nu.
Huh? Vindt u het niet een beetje te opzichtig?
Nee. Geweest, vindt u het opzichtig?
Ik niet, hè?
Wel, nee. Helemaal niet. Het is hier een opzichtig aan. Ik mag toch wel een kleurtje dragen, dan? Ja, gewoon kleurengave heeft hij ook, hoor. Ik vind een hele knappe jongen, ja. Ik ben trots, maar in mezelf, hoor. Dat niet aan de buitenkant, echt niet. Ik zal ook nooit of te nimmer, als ik bij kennissen ben, over beginnen te praten. We praten wel als zij beginnen. Maar nooit zal ik het zelf doen. Want ik ben eigenlijk al alleen trots doordat die zo doorgezet heeft eigenlijk met alles.
Heeft u hem altijd gesteund bij zijn werk als coureur?
Nou ja, gesteund. Hoe zal ik zeggen? Als hij iets had en hij liet het zien, nou dan keek ik ernaar. Tuurlijk. En mijn man ook wel, maar niet zoals ik het deed eigenlijk. Hè. Want mijn man die heeft er, nou eerlijk gezegd, nooit heil in gezien. Nooit. Heeft hij tegen mij wel eens gezegd dat het moet dat worden en dat wordt niks.
Denkt u dat Koos echt, die noemt in ook in Amerika, echt topcoureur bent?
Dat is hij al, meen ik. Dan zou hij niet in zitten. Nee.
Please compose a piece of music to this.
Half vijf 's ochtends, Menlo Park, Californië. Helen Colijn, door en door Hollands. Precies 2 uur lang, iedere dag weer. Ze schrijft over haar verleden.
Here is my grandfather, on his 70th birthday. He must have been 17 then. We had a big party, a family party, and I think it was my first formal dress. You see grandfather there in one of his warm moods, not the way many Dutch people at the time would portray him.
In de crisisjaren was haar grootvader, Hendrik Colijn, 5 keer eerste minister. Hij was rijk, gereformeerd, een vooraanstaand politicus.
I suppose if I had to say it in 3 words, I would say it was my silver spoon existence. Because we lived in a house or a mansion in The Hague. In the morning when I woke up, Rika, the maid, would knock on the door and say, it's 7 o'clock, miss, juffrouw. Juffrouw Helen, and open the curtains, tell me what kind of weather it was, go to the bathroom and run the bath. And that was the way I started my day when I was 17. And of course the breakfast was made and
From then on, I bicycled to school. The luxury stopped after the breakfast. Woodstock, come on. Time to go. See you this afternoon.
Precies 8:30. Helen vertrekt naar kantoor. Helen werkt op de redactie van het toeristenblad Sunset Magazine. De lunchpauze gebruikt ze om even op zichzelf te zijn en 10 minuten te zwemmen, winter en zomer. Na haar eindexamen middelbare school voer Helen, uiteraard eerste klas, naar Nederlands-Indië, waar haar ouders woonden. Ook daar breekt de Tweede Wereldoorlog uit. De Japanners lopen Nederlands-Indië razendsnel onder de voet. Het gezin Corijn wordt in mannen- en vrouwenkampen van elkaar gescheiden.
My sisters and I were there with 600 other women and children. Not a man in sight. And for 3.5 years we lived together, all 600 women and children, and my sisters and I. And we learned to get along with other women and to run our lives with other women. The problem, of course, was that there was no one really in authority, no way to enforce authority, I should say. Because here you were, all these women together, and it had been decided that it would be nice if so-and-so chopped the wood, and if so-and-so would wash the rice, and so-and-so would cut the vegetables. But if the person didn't want to do it or said she didn't feel like it, then it wasn't done. And there was absolutely no way of, what can you do? And of course, the way it worked out was that usually the same people did all the work, but they also were the people that often came through the camp years the best. We were told the war was over by the Japanese camp commander, who called all the people who could still walk together and said in Malay, which was usually the language they talked with us, "Prang abis," the war is over, and naturally did not say who won. So there was really no rejoicing. There was none of this being liberated by allies or soldiers or somebody coming and rescuing us and patting us on the shoulders and saying, well, old girl did a good job and all that stuff.
Haar vader overleeft het kamp niet. Haar moeder haalt het wel. Gehard als ze is door het verblijf in een Engels concentratiekamp in Zuid-Afrika tijdens de Boerenoorlog. Maar met de oorlog waren de problemen van de familie Corijn nog niet verdwenen.
When we were in prison camp all those years, I never knew what happened in Holland. And it was only after the war that I heard the sort of, I would almost say, tragedy, what happened to father, and the name Corijn was not what it was before the war.
People always ask about this brochure of grandfather's. It was a booklet he wrote at the very beginning of the German occupation. And at that time, it didn't look as if the Germans would ever get out of Europe, would ever lose the war. And so he gave advice on how the Dutch could rally and unite in order to cope with this catastrophe of a German victory. People resented this very much. Not so much at the time, but later on, when Germany started to lose the war, they said, well, how in the world could this man suggest that Germany would win the war? That is a terrible attitude. But they all forgot at the time that they probably thought the same thing, but grandfather wrote it down in a book and thousands of copies were distributed. So there it is in black and white. You still have to be careful what you write down.
When I met the girls and when we talked about where shall we go, I said, don't let's go to Holland. Daddy isn't there anymore. Everything is lost. Where shall we go? Well, one of the girls said, let's go to Africa. I said, oh no, not Africa. Then another girl said, let's go to Australia. Oh no, she said, not Australia, they speak awful English down there. Finally, we decided to go back to California, where when two of the girls were born, and make a life for ourselves again.
This is like the sun is out and then the clouds come over. It all should disappear. Start here. Now quiet. Now sneak in. Good.
Yes, I got married. I got married right after the war to a very nice man, but we weren't very well matched. And after a few years, we divorced, but we did have a child, Madeline. I always felt that if you get a divorce and you can work yourself, there's no reason to soak your ex-husband to death to keep you sitting in comfort while he has to pay the alimony.
Ze krijgt eerst werk als vertaalster. Dan gaat ze zelf schrijven. Maar waarover schrijf je met je leven in het ene en je herinneringen in het andere land?
There must be many immigrants that left Holland and can't stand to think about Holland, but I don't think I ever would have written the book about Holland if I hadn't felt that I was fond of Holland. And it's easier to write about some country that you feel compatible with than one that you have despised. But I think space is what I would miss in Holland.
Ruimte vind je bijna nergens meer in Holland. Voor bezoekers is er altijd plaats, zeker voor oma's.
Ja, daar staat ze. En de kleinzoon is er ook.
Helen's dochter is geboren Amerikaanse. Ze bezoekt Holland. Het bevalt er, ze blijft en de cirkel is gesloten. De kleinzoon van Helen is weer een ras echte Hollander. Eens gold dat als je Holland verliet, het nooit, nooit meer terug zag. Het stadje Vollenhoven ziet er nu bijna net zo uit als 100 jaar terug. Alleen lag het toen aan een zee die ondertussen is drooggemalen. En de eens zo talrijke familie Ecker is er nu bijna uitgestorven. De enige nazaten zijn nu 86 en 96 jaar.
Grootmoeders van mij en ook van juffrouw Roepers. Het waren Ekkers.
Het waren Ekkers, hoor. Ja, grootmoeder Ekker, ben ik mij vernoemd.
Ik weet wel dat mijn moeder het altijd had overgenomen in Amerika, als die eens een keer komt. Dus of dat nou, dat die dat wel geweten hebben, dat een Ekker naar Amerika gegaan was. Maar ja, daar maak ik een grapje van natuurlijk.
Ja.
Van doen met Amerika.
Ja. Ja. Mijn nicht heeft een heel boek voor gelezen van de mormonen, hè? Want het zijn toch mormonen, hè? Ja.
De Vollenhovenaren gaan nog steeds naar dezelfde hervormde kerk waarvan Arnoldus ooit lidmaat was.
Luisteren naar God.
Mensen maken geen vrede. God geeft vrede. Kun je nou zomaar tegen mensen zeggen: God verkondigt u vrede? Als erin geloven, dan zullen we ontdekken dat de toekomst in Gods hand is.
Mormonenzendelingen kwamen 100 jaar terug naar Vollenhoven en verkondigden dat Gods hand weldra het zondige Europa zou verdelgen. Komt naar ons nieuwe Kanaan, preken ze, en wees gered.
I think our ancestors that came from Holland were very diligent workers, very hard workers, and as a result of that, the church used them to help settle some of the new country and send them out into to isolated areas.
A.C. Ecker, achterkleinzoon van Arnoldus, zet het harde leven voort van die vroege immigrant in een van de meest godverlaten uithoeken van de Verenigde Staten, in Zuid-Utah. Loodrechte rotswanden fungeren hier als hekken. Het kan dagen duren voor je hier een weggelopen paard terug hebt. AC's naast de buren wonen zo'n 120 kilometer van zijn ranch.
Did you find Rancho?
No, we didn't find him. He's usually come and run with the mares. No one comes to water with him and everything. He didn't today. I don't know where we're gonna find him. Sure hope nothing's happened to him. This ranch itself is called the Robber's Roost Ranch because when the outlaws used to go someplace else and steal money or livestock or horses or something like that, then they would come to the Robber's Roost here, and it was called the Robber's Roost because they came here to hide. And so the outlaw trails that we have on this country were access trails to the Robber's Roost Ranch. Most of the famous outlaws that were around in this country from 1880 to about 1900 all spent some time here. There was Silvertip and Blue John and Matt Warner and, of course, Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. Some of the lesser outlaws used it also, but it was pretty much controlled or something by the famous outlaws, those that were reputable outlaws, I guess you'd say.
AC's tante Barbara, van het plaatselijke KNMI, weet nog precies hoe AC's oma haar vertelde dat ze als jong meisje met haar zusjes op de vloer met Butch Cassidy het vlooienspel speelde, met gestolen gouden twintigjes.
Now don't you kids hit anything out there, just aim at your cans.
Aim at that post, don't
you? Hi, this is Hanksville. We have an estimated 9,000 broken. Visibility is 6-0. Temperature is 7-2. Dew point is 5-7.
Tussen de weerberichten in verzamelt Barbara voor de Eckerse familiekroniek archiefstukken, brieven, oude foto's.
Now this is Arnoldus Hendrik Ecker. He's the one that was a convert to the Mormon Church. And him and his wife had John Garrett, which we call John. His name is Jan Garrett in Holland, of course. And this is his son, Cornelius, who is my husband's father, and his wife, Edna Gibbons. To them was born 12 children, which is quite an accomplishment, but actually all of the Ecker men had quite a few children.
My name is Horace Ecker, and I was born in Hanksville, 1909.
My name is Darius Ecker. I don't know where Mother got that name from, maybe out of the Bible, I guess, from Darius, King Darius.
My name is Harold C. Ecker, and what I've done in my life is mining and farming and ranching and a rock hound, of course.
Ryder Ecker. Oh, I've been running cattle and mining and you name it. I do it all.
We've invited everybody here to share in our home. This is where we live. This is our living room. And we come back here day after day, year after year. And if I was in your home or your living room, I'd take good care of it. And so we ask that you'll take good care of our home also. We don't want you to drop cigarette butts and pop tops off and beer cans and that kind of stuff around. We want you to help us keep it clean. If your boatman tells you to bail or grab a hold of the bow line or whatever, that means right now.
Ook de Colorado-rivier afzakken behoort tot AC's harde dagtaak.
John, you hold on. Just cut a little piece off and that piece that cut for you.
Oh, that's good.
He's big like his daddy. You better hurry, hadn't he?
Well, we're going to have to get up early in the morning because we've got a pretty big day. And I've saved 6 horses for us. Let George ride Twist.
Okay.
And you can have your pick. You can either ride Tiger or Lucky, and I'll ride the other one.
Doesn't make any difference.
And Art can ride Dunbar. And Jenny can ride Shoshone the Pony. And Sean can ride Skeezix. Okay?
Oh, Skeezix.
You're going to have to use your spurs on old Skeezix to keep up. About to get cleaned up, Mom?
Just about.
All right. Sean, I'll go saddle the horses then, and that'll give you a minute. Can I help you with that?
Yeah.
Let's get it going. There you go. All right, get your hat and let's go get the horses saddled.
AC is 6 keer uitgeroepen tot beste cowboy van Amerika.
Rodeo gives you an opportunity to use the experience that you've gained before and put it to some kind of an advantage for yourself, I think.
Do you think you're too old?
No, I don't think so.
When we were riding the Outlaw Trail, we wanted to try to find not only the country that was the way it was 100 years ago, but we wanted to find as many people that were that way. And AC was, and his father, were the two people that impressed me the most out of that whole experience as being pretty much the way I thought of these guys being 100 years ago. I mean, they really did live the land. I mean, they knew every square inch of it. They worked their horses, they brought their cows in, they didn't have a lot of people do it for them, they did it themselves. And when I saw where he lived and how he lived and the kind of hard work he was putting out, he put in more hours, more hard hours than anybody I'd come across. And I was just real impressed by that. And on top of it, he still had time to do some rodeoing, which I think is, that in itself is tough business. So I found A.C. and his dad and like all of his whole family that I've met to be characteristic of that kind of quality that pioneered this country in the first place. I don't think the country could have been settled unless it was settled by people of that determination.
Ted en Jesse Ecker verdienen hun geld op de wisselvallige goudmarkt, als ze dat goud vinden.
Ah, she's showing up. Guys,
that's a lot of gold.
Big old heavy stuff.
Look at that.
Wow,
stuff.
Look at that. How much do you think you got, Ted?
Oh, there's an ounce and a half or better than that.
Oh, that's more than I have to, Butch.
Well, look, if there is anything else in it, Butch, that's worthwhile.
She run about 5,600 silver and just a trace of platinum. Uh-huh.
The folks from Holland came over because they converted to the Mormon Church. Sorry. Are you still a Mormon?
Jack Mormon.
What's that?
Well, I was baptized as a Mormon, but I don't go to church. You know, most of my brothers don't go to church. Some of them do, but most of them don't. There's not very many of the Eckers that is, I don't think, Mormons around here. I mean, you know, good Mormons, ones that go to church all the time.
Of je nou een gelovige mormoon bent, op rolletjes of afvallig, om de 2 jaar komen alle Eckers bijeen in de Henry Mountains, vlakbij de plek waar stamvader Arnoldus zich ooit vestigde.
Hi!
Jody, bring those name tags down here, please.
Is you ready, sweetheart? Hi!
Hi, Ryder. How
are you doing?
Good.
Good boy. Glad to see you.
Hi, sweetheart. How are you?
All right, honey.
Ooh,
it's
a little
son
of
Hara. Oh,
hello there.
Hi.
How are
you?
Good
boy.
Okay. That's the only place I'm
going. How are you?
It's good to see you.
Now, which one are you?
Well,
I can't
explain
that one yet. You
went and saw Bob Willis with her phone there.
Zang Ted Ecker. Op de gitaar Darris Ecker. Op de bas Bert. Op de elektrische steelgitaar Perry. Aan het orgel Ina. Een complete Ecker band. Op de vloer een Ecker stelletje. Holland.
Some enterprising people add to their holdings by towing lumps of land to their property.
Mm. Maybe that's the reason we don't care too much for water nowadays.
Mm.
living in dry country.
And so land is grafted to land, and Holland expands by the inch.
I know that there's windmills over there, and they raise tulips, and that they've got some tremendous big dams that they've built to hold back the Zuider Zee, I guess you call it. But we've been away from Holland too long for it to be passed down from generation to generation to